Thank you, Rich, and welcome back to the booth here at Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. I am joined by a pair of Hall of Famers, Luis Scott Vargas and Randy Buehler, and we are excited to bring you finals coverage here. You heard it from Rich. This is one of the most exciting finishes to a season and to a Pro Tour that we've seen. Owen Turtenwald really gave us a sweat on if he was going to get into the top eight. He did make it in. Now he finds himself in the finals. Only
now
one man
win
standing
left. Double digits. He's no gonna, problem.
He's going to crush Player of the Year. He's got that locked up. He doesn't have this trophy locked up. Lukas Blohon from the Czech Republic stands in his way. It's time for the finals, guys. Let's head down to the feature match area. Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Randy Buehler and Luis Scott Vargas, and it's time for the finals. It has been a long tournament here for Owen Turtenwald. He started things off 10-0, had a little shaky finish, but he ended up making it into the top eight, and now he finds himself sitting down in the finals. He's playing Teamer Emerge. This is his fourth Pro Tour top eight. He is Hall of Fame elect as of Saturday. His opponent on the other side of the table, Lukas Blohon, from the Czech Republic, is playing Black-White Control. This is his second Pro Tour Top 8. The last one came about 4 years ago. And we're going to be playing a best of five here. The first two games, no sideboards allowed. After that, sideboards are in play. Luis, can you give us a big picture perspective on the matchup?
Just like the last one, it's all about Emrakul. In this case, Owen's playing a deck that Emrakul's a lot faster and a lot better than Sam's deck, because Owen has way more ways to fill his graveyard, way more ways to find Emrakul, and has cards like Elder Deep Fiend that really set up Emrakul nicely. So, plus, Owen just has more Emrakuls. He has three Emrakuls in his deck.
About Emrakul, Randy?
Yeah, in fact, Owen Turtenwald wasn't sure what deck to play leading up to the Pro Tour. There's actually a funny Kai put together kind of a nice meme about this. Owen was debating. He was on white-black control. He almost played the deck Lukas Blohon is playing in the finals, but you know what? He got tired of losing to Emrakul decks in the Pantheon testing house. So he switched to what he thought was their best Emrakul deck because of this exact matchup.
Cannot be good news for Lukas Blohon. Owen Turtenwald, of course, tested with Team Pantheon. Lukas was testing with Team Eureka this time around. Two of the top teams on the Pro Tour easily. And it looks like read the bones here for Lukas Blohon. He's going to bottom both of the cards with a scry and draw two. He's got a Liliana. We saw this in his semifinal game, by the way, Luis, the one that you and I just covered, that Liliana was a major problem from Sam Pardee. He wasn't playing the same deck as Turtenwald. Is it going to be the same issue here for Owen?
So Owen doesn't have any spells that directly can kill Liliana, but he has more creatures to attack with, including some that can be played at instant speed, like the Elder Deep Fiend. And Owen does Emrakul better than Sam does, so he's going to be able to assemble an Emrakul before Liliana's Emblem can kill him, and potentially string together multiple Emrakuls to be able to win through Emrakul attacks.
Okay.
That being said, a quick Liliana does provide a threat. Owen does have to respect that.
Currently, he has nothing that can pressure Liliana, and she's already on 5 loyalty.
Liliana versus Emrakul. That's how the KOTOR Eldritch Moon is supposed to end,
right? It's played out many times in the feature match area. I'll tell you what, Liliana's emblem usually does beat Emrakul, which is, it's got to be a flavor win.
So one of the kind of failure points of Owen's deck, or one of the points you can attack it at, is that he doesn't have very many creatures to sacrifice to emerge. So he's got these Elder Deep Fiends and the Wretched Griff that he wants to emerge out, but really just has the Pilgrim's Eyes and Gnarlwood Dryads to sacrifice, plus occasionally an Ishkana. So Lukas playing a ton of removal spells can, you know, if Lukas aggressively goes after those small creatures, Owen might have some difficulty casting his Giant Eldrazi.
Grapple with the Pass is going to get an island back from Owen's graveyard.
So, yeah, six types.
Not the most exciting, but he may have wanted to leave the Gnarlwood Dryad in his graveyard in order to power out Emrakul.
Yeah, he does have six types. Yeah, he's got six card types already.
Yeah, so Owen's like a turn away from Emrakuling here.
He is. If he plays his land here, that'll give him his six mana source.
Yeah, I believe the deck is capable of a turn 5 Emrakul. He's on track for a turn 6 Emrakul this game.
Meanwhile, Liliana ticking up. We could have that classic fight here.
One ingredient missing from Owen's hand, though.
Oh, no. No Emrakul.
He's going to need to grapple into it or just potentially draw it.
Wow, he's holding 5 lands and a grapple at this point. And all he's done is play mana and a Pilgrim's Eye.
Yeah, Owen's deck is ramping, but if he... I mean, he's got the 4 Gather the Pack and 4 Grapple and 4 Vessel. He's got a lot of ways to find Emrakul, but currently, yeah, he does not have access to her.
Lukas Blohan's turn now, and he's got Liliana, the Last Hope, at 6 Loyalty. Sorry, this is the end step for Owen Turtenwald. Yep. Now it's Lukas Blohan's turn. Liliana at 6, and he has Archangel Avacyn on the team as well. He's going to go ahead and plus Liliana. That's going to kill the Pilgrim's Eye and get Lukas in there for 4 damage with Archangel Avacyn.
Yeah, for sure Lukas wants to race to Liliana Emblem here. He's living on borrowed time. Eventually Emrakul comes down, and you know, cards like Anguished Unmaking are a huge liability since you can't cast them on Emrakul. She has protection from instants. Lukas then untaps, takes his turn, and Owen gets to make him point Anguished Unmaking at his own planeswalkers or creatures.
That's a 7th card type going.
That is a 7th card type, which is kind of interesting because Lukas has the option of Anguish on making that Gravestone, but doesn't look as appealing now.
Yeah, it won't actually keep Owen off of Emrakul, which is something Lukas has to consider. He does force Owen to have the land, but I don't think that's something that you're too concerned with.
But without the artifact in the graveyard there, I think it would have kept him off of it. So an interesting decision there from Blohan to go ahead and kill the Pilgrim's Eye anyway. Now, we know that at least currently Turtenwald does not have an Emrakul in his hand.
Well, here's
but
grapple.
Here's a grapple, so let's see if he finds one. Nope. No. Well, an Elder Deep Fiend.
Yeah, Elder Deep Fiend's a start. One other thing to note is Owen hasn't milled a Kozilek's Return yet either. One of the ways his deck functions is that uses, you know, the grapples and vessels and gathers to put a Kozilek's Return in the graveyard so they could cast that Elder Deep Fiend, trigger Kozilek's Return. But. Owen has missed on that as well. Now that Lukas has the additional information of Elder Deep Fiend, he may want to kill the Gravestone. He paused Owen for a second there. Looks like Ishkana is giving Owen at least a play this turn that can hold off Avacyn.
Again, though, Owen Turtenwald just to turn off and being able to cast his threats here. Elder Deep Fiend costs 8 mana if you're not getting rid of anything. Could have been part of the reason why Lukas wanted to kill that Pilgrim's Eye as well.
Yeah, going after Pilgrim's Eye is a pretty good idea if you have the opportunity to.
But look, Liliana's on 7.
Yeah, Liliana is
Ishkana
going to
all you want. I can't imagine that Ishkana can try to race a Liliana emblem.
It can buy Owen some time, but
Kay. It
won't quite get there. Of course, Owen.
I feel like Lukas wants more time with that emblem now.
And Owen can Deep Fiend here. He's got that 2 blue to go with Ishkana.
And it looks like that decision is going to be put to him immediately.
Which means if he's going to do it, he has to do it on his own end step.
That's right, which is a pretty awkward time to do it. And he's not even going to bother. And none of this interacts, by the way, with Liliana.
Nope.
So are we going to see Lukas Blohan just play a Liliana, march her straight up to ultimate, and just start... piling on zombies again?
That's been his plan so far.
He's got a Linval in his hand as well. There we go. It's an emblem.
In one of the last turns where Linval actually gives Lukas an angel, because Lukas is currently outnumbered.
He is ahead on life, so he won't get that bonus. Archangel Avacyn's going to hit the red zone. Owen's not going to bother chump blocking. He's going to fall to 12. And here we go. All aboard the zombie train. There's 2 of them. Every end step, he's going to get 2 plus the number that he already has. And the thing gets out of control very, very quickly. If Owen doesn't have a way to manage it. Lukas Blohan at 18 life.
Owen drew another Pilgrim's Eye, so he can at least turbo out Deep Fiend a little bit if he wants to, but he's he's running out of time here. Because the problem is, not only does Owen, you know, is he eventually just going to die to this zombie horde and all these angels, even if Owen's able to delay his death and then draw Emrakul, if Owen's board presence has been reduced by having a chump block, then the Emrakul doesn't do as much. Nope. Owen needs not only an Emrakul, but like a good Emrakul turn.
And it's so difficult with that emblem out there, because it just turns out a bunch of zombies as part of the extra turns anyway.
Yeah, we saw Sam Pardee concede during an Emrakul turn.
Yeah.
He knew he was going to die next turn.
Lucas seemed a little surprised that Owen was going to allow him go into combat. I think he expected that Elder Deep Fiend. He knows he's got it in his hand. Now it looks like he's going to take a minute to decide, well, actually, do I really want to attack then?
Yeah. Look, all Lucas's creatures, except for the zombies, fly, so the Elder Deep Fiend isn't actually ambushing anything.
And Owen is in maximum life total preservation mode here, blocking the two biggest creatures so far, and in fact the third. Does he have to block a zombie as well? He's deciding now.
So it seems like there's a good chance we see a mid-combat Elder Deep Fiend here, because if damage resolves, Owen no longer has the ability to cast it, which would just let him tap down some of Lucas's lands. Looks like Owen is just not interested in casting the Deep Fiend. Maybe he just wants to find Kozilek's Return before he casts Elder Deep Fiend.
Another Liliana. Both zombies survived that combat, by the way, so that means that four more are going to join the fray.
Yeah, and it's becoming, I think, pretty clear that even if Owen draws an Emrakul, he's going to need something like Kozilek's Return into Emrakul to get out of this. Even if Owen taps down four things this turn, Lucas could actually just go for the win.
Yeah. Owen scoops him
up. Speaking of going for the win, Owen sees the writing on the wall, and game one goes to Lukas Blohon. And Liliana, it must be said. That is the second top eight game that we've seen Lukas win by just marching Liliana to ultimate territory and getting a ton of zombies. We'll be back right after these messages.
Put what you've learned from watching the Pro Tour into action next weekend at Game Day. Test your skills and your new standard deck at a store near you. Top finishers are awarded special Game Day prizes, including full art premium promo cards and a champion playmat for the winner. Test drive the top standard decks from this Pro Tour in the Pro Tour Gauntlet, beginning this Wednesday on Magic Online. For more information, visit mtgo.com.
And welcome back to the feature match area here at Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. We're in Sydney, Australia. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Louis Scott Vargas and Randy Buehler. Got some kind of interesting little sub-games going on here as well. We've got, on one side of the table, three-fifths of the color pie fighting the other two-fifths.
Sure.
and then we've kind of got Liliana versus Emrakul somehow here as well. As, you know, one way that Lucas can win the game is by doing what he just did there, either ultimating Liliana or just leveraging her value abilities. On the other side of the table, Owen's deck is really geared towards getting Emrakul down and winning through that, though Elder Deep Fiend has done a lot of work for him this weekend as well.
Also worth noting that last game, Owen, he did a lot of self-milling. His deck, again, has these 12 cards that put cards from his deck into his graveyard, never hit a Kozilek's Return. And
yeah,
his deck is really built around having access to at least one of those over the course of a game.
Also, no Emrakul, even with those grapples to try to get it back.
Right. Owen saw, I don't know exactly how many cards, but it felt like over a third of his deck, and you know, if not substantially more, and was not able to find an Emrakul.
Yeah, there's three Emrakuls in the main deck for Owen. I'll remind you that the players are going to be going to sideboarded games after this game, but this one, no sideboard, so they're just going to get shuffled up and right back down to action. We do play a best of five match here, though, in the top eight.
I feel like best of three would have been representative during my match, but
you'll have to talk to Scott Larrabee about that one. It might be a tough sell.
Is okay. Lucas just going to run out the turn three Liliana again? Is that what's just going
to
happen?
It could be. Owen has a few ways to pressure a Liliana early in the game. Gnarlwood Dryad's one of them, but especially in a non-sideboarded game, Lukas has so much extra spot removal for small creatures. It's hard to imagine that, you know, a Pilgrim's Eye or a Gnarlwood Dryad is something that's really going to survive for very long.
There's the combo right there. Owen casts Gather the Pack, and he sees a Kozilek's Return heading to his graveyard, picking up the Wretched Griff, which will then trigger the Kozilek's Return.
Not
so
bad.
His deck, you know, doing the thing it's designed to do in this game.
And here's Transgress the Mind now for a Blohon. He knows he has one target for it, and it looks like he's got three different options.
Nissa's Pilgrimage is one of the key cards to this deck. You see Owen's got one in his hand, because that'll ramp him up to five mana for Ishkana. Also, just make sure that he is able to hit his land drops. And frequently, he's got Spell Mastery, though, and it looks like it's on right now as well, because of the Gather and the Kozilek's Return.
You think Lukas is just going to take away the Pilgrimage here and stunt his development for the next turn? He can only play a Gnarlwood Dryad, barring his draw step.
It's a solid option. Given that Owen has two big spells in his hand, the Wretched Griff and the Ishkana.
Mm-hmm. That is what he takes.
So Owen's going to miss the ramping aspect of Nissa's Pilgrimage here, given that, you know, he's not able to cast one. But he actually has enough lands to cast his spell, so he's not in that bad a shape otherwise.
Randy, this looks pretty bad for Owen if Lukas just plays Liliana and pluses it here. Now, is he on full Delirium here? Is that a 3-3 Gnarlwood Dryad?
Yes, he's already delirious.
Okay, still doesn't look great, though, for Owen.
It's a lot better than having it die.
Indeed.
You can pressure Liliana for one.
That was a great draw for Owen. He drew a Vessel of Nascency, so he's going to, instead of doing nothing this turn, he's going to be able to spend three mana to advance his game and give himself better options here.
All right, that's some business.
Yeah, that's an Emrakul.
He sees an Emrakul. He's got plenty of lands in his hand. I also note that he put a Corrupted Graphstone in, though. I guess there's a Pilgrim's Eye in there already. Yeah, it looks like it.
So interesting, Owen chose to sacrifice the Vessel main phase. One of the reasons he would do that is to decide which land to play, have full information if he had to take a land. But now Lukas knows that Emrakul, the end is coming at some point here.
Mm, indeed. Five card types in Owen Turtenwald's graveyard. We'll keep a track of that for you because it really does matter for what turn he's able to cast that Emrakul that he got. In the meantime, he attacks Liliana with his Gnarlwood Dryad, but it's kind of limping over the red zone there. Only pecks in for one damage thanks to Liliana's ability. She's back down to three loyalty. Read the bones there for Lukas Blohon. Take a look at Blohan's hand here. Not bad. Hollowed Moonlight as well. It's a main deck card for Lukas, as you can see.
It can stop Ishkana from making some tokens.
Hmm. Doesn't do much against Wretched Griff, though. So there goes the Gnarlwood Dryad, and Owen is going to upgrade that to a 3-4 with Flying and draw himself a card as well. Another land off the top for Lukas Blohon. He has Liliana still sitting at 3 loyalty after that last sequence.
Wretched Griff, not quite a Mold Drifter, but it really does play an important role in this deck. Mm. A cheaper Emerge creature is necessary.
Owen just plays one copy of Wretched Griff in the main, but I gotta say, it's done serious work for him. Of course, it has that magical number 7 up in the corner, and it does trigger.
Still ties to Obnixilis, though.
Yeah, and that's exactly what happens here. Lukas Blohon is going to play Obnixilis Reignited, shoot down the Wretched Griff.
So Owen, a turn away from casting Emrakul if he can play lands on the next two turns. And he's got Nissa's Pilgrimage, but he's not even going to need to cast it here since he's got another land to play, it looks like.
Okay, and there's Ishkana for Owen Turtenwald. Now, he did catch Lukas Blohon tapped out there, so the spiders are intact. And Lukas is going to immediately plus Obnixilis to get his card so he can map out his turn.
Well, if Lukas doesn't have another transgress, then we're going to see an Emrakul here. And wow. Lukas has to figure out, like, how badly is my turn going to go for me when Owen plays it?
Well, Lukas is going to do some damage, wipe the board of Ishkina, using a combination of Languish and the plus ability on Liliana. But Randy, you know, normally you're pretty excited to have two Planeswalkers on the battlefield, but when your opponent gets to decide what to do with them, it looks a little worse.
You still want them. I mean, Lukas played turn three Liliana. Owen has been unable to get it off the board. Played turn five Obnixilis, and it's done a little bit. I mean, is this Emrakul turn going to be good enough?
Well, we're going to find out now, because that is Emrakul, the Promise End, going on the stack for Owen Turtenwald. He could not find this in the first game, but he does have it here on the seventh turn, and he's going to pass the turn to himself, as it were. This is Lukas Blohan's turn.
It's an extra turn. In the middle there, right?
It is.
So Blighted Fen can kill the 13-13 flyer.
It can.
Owen.
That is not good news for Turtenwald.
Yeah, and it's target opponent, so there's nothing Owen can do about it.
That's right. He cannot even sacrifice it targeting Lukas, even if there weren't a creature there. It's just going to happen. So Turtenwald has to go for kind of a... Let's see what he's got.
I'm feeling Obnixilis and Avacyn are not friends.
Yeah, that looks like they had a little fight, so they're going to go away.
Obnixilis, or Avacyn protecting herself from Obnixilis, but Grasp ending those dreams anyway.
That's right. It didn't matter anyway. Remember that Avacyn, the trigger that she has when she enters the battlefield counts for her, too. She was indestructible there. But Owen Turtenwald was fine with that. He still got to get rid of Obnixilis in that sequence, and then, of course, the Grasp of Darkness to take down Avacyn. So we kind of went for a value Emrakul there, Luis.
Yeah.
Wasn't a game ender, right? That wasn't the one that just finished the game, especially as we see Emrakul hit the graveyard thanks to that Blighted Fen.
Yeah.
And still Liliana left over.
Owen's going to need, in a lot of cases, to be able to Deep Fiend into Emrakul or do something along those lines so that he's got a board that can force Lukas to throw away more cards, but... Even in this case, Emrakul did trade for a bunch of different cards. Traded for Obnixilis, Grasp, Avacyn, and eventually Blighted Fen.
Mm-hmm.
Though Lukas did get to draw an extra card because he gets an extra turn out of the exchange.
One in play, one in my hand. And right away, another one.
Sure. So it looks like a pair of Nissa's Pilgrimages here for Owen Turtenwald.
And that's it.
Yeah.
He's down to just lands in hand.
Did he
run out of forests?
He found three forests total between the two.
Of a possible six?
Yeah, because he was out of forests. He had milled a bunch. What it does mean is that Owen doesn't have tons of land left in his deck, so he's gonna need to draw out of this, but he's got a decent amount of different cards he could draw that would be good here. He doesn't have tons of time because Liliana is marching steadily upwards, and then, of course, Linval is just putting a 5/5 into play.
That's right. It's also going to gain Lukas Blohon life here as well as it enters the battlefield. He was behind, so he's going to gain 5.
Elder Deep Fiend, not a bad card to have here. It can Kozlek's Return away the Linvala and tap down some permanents, though Owen does know that Lukas has another Avacyn in hand, so if Owen waits on the Elder Deep Fiend, then Avacyn can stop the Kozlek's Return. And of course, as you've seen come up many times in the tournament, Owen can then choose not to use the return. So.
That's right.
So you're gonna go from main phase Deep Fiend?
Yeah, he wants to return to successfully kill that the Linvala is.
I love that he's tapping the Planeswalker there. It doesn't matter,
yeah.
But it's kind of sweet.
I tapped a Planeswalker with Tamiyo in this tournament.
Interesting for Lukas Blohon, he drew a Grasp of Darkness. And he has a Kalatas as well. Is he just going to try to play Protect the Liliana here? He can do a good job of that with these two cards. He's put himself out a blocker, and then he can shrink down the Elder Deep Fiend actually two different ways, one with Liliana and one with Grasp.
Yeah, as is Elder Deep Fiend already can't attack past Kalitas because the Liliana minus mm-hmm. 2/-1, so Owen's presumably just going to be unable to pressure Liliana at all.
basically just gains Lucas three life. So, yeah, he's just going to have to pass the turn back to Turtenwald. Gosh, these games have been all about Liliana. She's up there on six loyalty, and he has not activated Liliana yet this turn either. And this could be another Liliana ultimate next turn if Owen doesn't find a way to interact.
Yeah, Owen would love to draw another Emrakul. Another Deep Fiend could give Owen a shot here, though. With that Grasp, if Lucas leaves mana up for that, then he's unable to get in for damage with the Deep Fiend either.
Still Avacyn in hand as well for Blohon, and you mentioned it earlier, Luis, but Owen knows about it. Okay, so what happened there was Liliana plus target Elder Deep Fiend. Lukas Blohon attacked with Kalatas. Owen blocked, and before damage, Lukas Blohon shrunk it down further with a Grasp, rendering it dead. This is a big draw step for Owen.
And a little Pilgrim's Eye.
Pilgrim's Eye is not going to get the job done here. In fact, he's not even going to bother playing it, and Lukas Blohon can now ultimate Liliana again.
Unbelievable.
Lucas could also just play End of Turn Avacyn and start attacking.
He's going to have probably just
both
options, right? Wow.
Sure.
Looks like he's going to sacrifice a zombie to Kalatas to put a couple of counters on him. Is he kind of forcing the issue on a potential Deep Fiend here from Turtenwald?
He's making Kozlik's return a little less impactful as well by putting Kalitas out of range. But
yeah, that's what I mean. He's saying, look, if you want to do that, you got to do it now. But no, here we go. Liliana Emblem yet again. And he is just going to take over with this again. Pair of zombies on end step for Lukas Blohon.
Yeah, there's that Kozlik's return. But even if Owen Kozlik's returns a bunch of zombies away, Kalitas just gets to devour them and grow larger and larger.
Indeed. And they'll be back. And now Lukas Blohon is going to use this opportunity to play Archangel Avacyn. There's going to be a response, though. Owen knows he needs to clear out these two zombies.
This also denies Lucas the ability to flip Avacyn, which he could do by thanks to sacrificing a zombie.
Mm. Lucas may as well gobble up one of them. It's going to die anyway.
Yeah, and thanks to sacrificing a zombie a turn earlier, even a Kozlek's return, the flashback here off of a Deep Fiend wouldn't kill Kalidas.
Yep.
Nope. I responded to the Avacyn being cast.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, a little sequencing discussion there, but they got it sorted out. Archangel Avacyn will not be transforming here. Nothing died while she was on the battlefield, so ultimate price off the top for Lukas Blohon, who is very much in the driver's seat in game two against Owen Turtenwald.
How much white-black control did you guys expect, Luis?
We did not expect a ton because of how weak it was to Emrakul. We underestimated how much Emrakul was going to be in the tournament, so we thought there was going to be a decent contingent on white-black, and it turns out, Lukas Blohon aside, it was not very well represented.
Yeah, it was a decent chunk of the day one metagame. Didn't do particularly well. Lucas is making it look great, though. I mean, for what is allegedly a bad matchup for Lucas, it's looked kind of easy these two games. Is that just Owen's bad draws?
That's a combination of that and Lucas just having turn three Liliana plus enough removal and pressure to back her up.
This one's winding down quickly. Lukas Blohon is going to go ahead and transform while gobbling up for more and more zombies to Kalatas. Avacyn the Purifier has arrived with Owen Turtenwald on one life. He finds Grapple with the pass off the top of his library. Does that give him any hope?
Well, it lets him Emrakul, but that won't necessarily do it. Because, again, thanks to that Liliana emblem, even if Owen successfully Emrakuls Lucas, then the emblem will make two zombies at the end of the Emrakul turn. So, though, if Lucas were tapped out, this actually could be go in an interesting way where Lukas casts, Owen makes Lukas cast Hallowed Moonlight to prevent the zombie emblem for a turn, which would be huge.
Especially given that every single zombie is lethal at this point.
I mean, Owen has some options, and Lukas has some draws that can let Owen survive, so Owen's certainly gonna go for it here.
Pilgrim's Eye? Sure.
There's a Pilgrim's Eye from Turtenwald, another chump blocker.
Presumably he's not going for Kozak's Return coming back here if he's casting Pilgrim's Eye first.
He wants a chump block. There's Grapple with the Past. We know there's an Emrakul in the graveyard already. There is now, I believe there are three copies of Kozilek's Return as well.
Looks like two and then one exiled.
Okay.
Potentially a third.
So two.
Owen could, again, he could Kozilek's Return here, but it doesn't, given that he played the Pilgrim's Eye first, I assume his intention is to not do that. Though it would kill the Abyssin.
He's passed the turn to Lukas Blohon. He will be taking that turn for Lukas.
So I think Lukas actually wants to get Hallowed Moonlight out of his hand here because it's just a liability.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
He's going to play it on end step and just cycle it away, draw a card.
Well, Owen is not dead here since he can kill both of Lukas's creatures and then have two creatures around to block zombies on Lukas's next turn.
So he can force...
Yeah, so Owen's going
to... Avacyn to attack.
Ultimate price, the Kalitas.
Mm-hmm.
Avacyn just can run into Emrakul and then cast Grasp on, like, the Avacyn before that happens. Or, actually, he's got enough mana to play another Kalitas and then...
And Grasp that.
And Grasp that. Also, he could Legend Rule the Kalitas away. So he's got a bunch of different options. Basically, Lukas is going to lose all his cards.
Everything.
Everything. Make two zombies off Emblem. Take a turn where if he draws a removal spell for Pilgrim's Eye, then Owen dies.
Then Owen's just dead.
Then it's going to be Owen's turn, facing down two zombies with Pilgrim's Eye Emrakul and a Liliana Emblem. So Owen's going to need to draw, like, running Elder Deep Fiends. But if he does, Emrakul does clock in for 13 a turn. So
This
game is not over, but Owen is definitely on the back foot here.
Three-turn clock for Owen Turtenwald. And let's not forget the Kozilek's Return in the graveyard as well. There's two of those that he can use to wipe away a bunch of zombies if he draws, again, Elder Deep Fiends and the like. So, Cletus, you mentioned the legend rule. You're only allowed to have one copy of each legendary creature. You get to choose which one, so Owen's going to choose the smaller one.
Oh, he can also kill zombies on end step here.
Oh, gobble up one of the zombies and still have enough mana for ultimate price? That does leave him, though... Or excuse me, not ultimate price, the Grasp of Darkness.
Because
ultimate price doesn't have a target right now.
So Owen chose to leave Lukas with an ultimate price instead of a zombie, essentially.
I like it.
Yeah, it works out well for Owen. He does need to draw something here. He's got...
He's at one.
He's at one facing down three zombies, or rather, four zombies, and he's got one creature. Grapple.
It's a grapple with the Past off the top for Turtenwald.
Jeez.
That'll at the very least, let's see, does he have an Elder Deep Fiend in his graveyard?
It's hard to see from
he's
here.
Got one exiled. So
he'll
can grab one hook
to
hit. Does not look like, I can't see an Eldrazi in the graveyard currently.
I don't see one either.
Okay.
There's a Wretched Griff in the graveyard.
But there's a Deep Fiend.
And he just found a Deep Fiend off of the grapple with the Past.
So
now,
the Deep Fiend being crucial that now he can trigger the Kozilek's Return at instant speed.
Exactly.
So Owen can still, he can attack for 14,
yep.
Pass the turn. Next turn, play Elder Deep Fiend to tap down four lands. I guess Wretched Griff's actually just better because either way, he's going to have to return before Lukas gets zombies end
That's
of turn.
Right. That's
fair.
Right.
Sure.
So he might as well just draw a card off the Wretched Griff. You can actually just sacrifice the Pilgrim's Eye, I think, because if you're going to trigger the return.
It's just going to die anyway.
Yeah.
It looks like Owen's lining up exactly that. So there's three. Wretched Griff, sacrifice to emerge. Kozilek's Return is going to trigger, then Wretched Griff is going to trigger, then Wretched Griff is going to resolve. Oh, and a pair of lands in hand for Owen.
Owen still needs to draw something here, since Lukas is going to get two zombies in turn. He drew a Shambling Event, so that's a third attacker. So now Owen's again facing down three attackers at one life, despite having.
So he has to hit again.
All right, it's a big draw step.
Oh, he gets a land. Three lands in hand for Owen Turtenwald. It looks like he's going to come up a little short here in game two.
Yeah, he can attack for 16. He can put Lukas down to six, but...
Crazy. All that extra life gained from Kalatas when he was just dumping plus one counters on him, it really paid off for Lukas here. He was at 36.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can only deal 30.
He's even drawn a Grasp of Darkness just to make sure that the deal gets sealed, and he's going to attack with everything. Lukas Blohon is now one game from being a Pro Tour champion.
Yeah, Owen was an Elder Deep Fiend or Chandra short of surviving at least another turn and potentially turning that game around.
He only needed one more turn.
Yep.
He could have attacked a sixth on that last turn that he had. He had to play, leave them on defense, but wow.
Okay, gents, let's settle in here. This is where things change. We're going to be now going to sideboarded games. You can see the players are already consulting their sideboards. So let's take a look at that right now. Owen Turtenwald, Teamer Emerge. Here's his sideboard. Anything jumping out to you guys? Randy, do you see anything that that you think would definitely be coming in here?
I haven't got the chance to see this matchup yet.
Yeah. Do you have any sense for it, Luis? This is a matchup I actually asked some of the pros out on the floor, and they were like, against Black-White? I don't know.
Well, Negate and Invasive Surgery are both have a lot of targets. Mm-hmm. Negate's traditionally been a good card against Black-White. Coax from the Blind Eternities is a fun
cool.
one, and Owen knows that Lukas has multiple copies of Infinite Obliteration, which is going to name Owen's Emrakul, presumably because Owen has three Emrakuls. So Coax can get Emrakul back into it, Owen's hand.
Transgress the Mind as well.
Right. Jace also traditionally pretty good in Den Protector in these kind of grindy matchups, especially since Owen doesn't need, you know, Gnarlwood Dryads or Kozak's Returns quite as much.
Are we anticipating Lukas taking out a bunch of spot removal spells?
Yeah, Lukas is not. First of all, ultimate price is has very, very few targets. Mm-hmm. Ishkana and potentially Gnarlwoods, which may even get boarded out. Lukas has over and over again relied on these Gideons against the Eldrazi deck. He just wants to be able to pressure the opponent. And then, of course, Transgress, Infinite Obliteration, and Duress is okay, but Owen, all of his spells are cheap and his creatures are expensive, so that's not a good combination for Duress, because when you draw Duress on turn 5 or 6, often Owen won't have very good targets. Also, Owen's spells all draw him into creatures, so you Duress Owen, he grapples into a creature in response, it just does not work out well for you.
I love the Infinite Obliteration dance with Coax from the Blind Eternities.
Yeah, going off is pretty nice. There's also a nice little loop you can do with Grapple from the Past and Jace. You, like, flip Jace, use it to flashback Grapple to get back Jace, and, like, you can just keep doing stuff like that. And so Owen is the one who's trying to loop Emrakuls. He's trying to get multiple Emrakuls triggers going on in a game, and Lukas is trying to kill him with Gideons before that can happen. Since we've seen this Liliana emblem be very, very successful, you actually see Liliana right there. Gideon is kind of does that, but just much, much faster. More vulnerable to Emrakul. Emrakul can't stop Liliana's emblem, can kill a Gideon, but most of the time. But Gideon does put Owen on a very quick clock here.
Yeah, that's a mural that we have in our feature match area behind, and I'll tell you, Liliana towers over the feature match area down there. It's really cool. She's got some zombies following her. There's some rats turning into Eldrazi rats. It's a really neat setup. Only one table in the feature match area left. This is the finals. Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. I've got Randy Bueller and Luis Scott Vargas with me. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe. And, this could be the game that decides the Pro Tour. If Lukas Blohon can find a victory, he will win 3-0 over Owen Turtenwald, and he's the one who will take that trophy home. But I got to say, he's playing one of the toughest players in the entire world, Owen Turtenwald, here. And Owen is going to make it as difficult as possible at every turn.
It was too tough for me, that's for sure.
Owen's going to be on the play in this first sideboarded game.
And Owen's got a Coax and an Emrakul in his hand, so...
Taking a look at the hands from our players as they get populated. We also get a little sneak peek with the cameras here.
And looks like Owen's on a two-lander with no green mana and a Pilgrim's Eye. This is
and a vessel, too. He does not have a lot going on.
When deciding his Pro Tour hopes and dreams, they hinge on whether he hits a third land on time. The hand's pretty solid if he does.
So Owen's currently in the process of deciding if he wants to mulligan this hand. It looks like it's really close for him.
Yeah, keeping two landers does not always work out.
Speaking from personal experience there, Luis.
Go.
Doesn't make it wrong. If you're supposed to keep it in the middle of the Swiss, you're supposed to keep it with a Pro Tour on the line, right? Go.
I believe he drew an Emrakul.
He did. It was an Emrakul on turn two. He really wants to find a land here, and he drew an Elder Deep Fiend.
Jeez.
Not like this, says Owen Turtenwald. Lukas Blohon, though, you know, his deck, not blazing fast, right? Like, look at his turn three play. He's done nothing this game, and he's going to play Infinite Obliteration. Wow, and get both Emrakuls out of Owen's hand.
I know exactly the feeling in the pit of Owen's stomach as he drew that Emrakul. Didn't want to draw land, drew a 13 drop. Also drew the card Lukas was going to name with Infinite Obliteration. So it was just like the worst of all possible worlds for Owen.
Worst possible draw for Owen Turtenwald. Now, he's been in tough situations before at the table. He's not going to let it bother him. But, yeah, you got to know he's feeling that.
Yeah, it looks like he actually sided out an Emrakul potentially because he thinks they're going to be targeted by Infinite Obliteration. We'll see if that's the case or not.
So one of them becomes a Coax from the Blind Eternities. It's which he can go grab from wherever it is at that time. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, all three. He's still at three. Three main. They're all in exile.
Okay. It looks like you got all three.
There it is.
Coax is for sure in the deck, though.
Yeah, it's in his hand. Yep. Another vessel off the top for Owen Turtenwald. He can't find anything. And are we going to see, yes, Gideon on turn four from Blohon. And this is exactly what Owen didn't want to see. And he cannot find another land here. And this clock, we've seen it before. Blohon can attack for seven right now.
So Owen may have to he's picked up several titles this weekend. Hall of Famer elect, Player of the Year. May not
but
be adding Pro Tour Champion to that list.
Starting to feel that way. Is there any sequence of draws at this point, Luis, that Owen can find his way out? He's so far behind now.
Unfortunately not. I think even if Owen draws a forest this turn, which he did, the best possible scenario, I don't really see how he battles back. He missed three land drops.
Yeah, it doesn't make it wrong to keep that hand. It just sometimes they don't work out.
Yeah, Owen Turtenwald's all the way down to 11 after Lukas Blohon looks to shut the door as quickly as possible. He activated his Shambling Vent attack for 9 damage last turn.
Yeah, and Lukas even has removal to get the Pilgrim's Eye out of the way here.
He does exactly that. He's going to activate. This is going to put Turtenwald down to 2 life, and there's just nothing he can do. What a tough way to go out for Turtenwald, but Lukas Blohon says, I'll take it. It's a den protector for Turtenwald. Turtenwald's not one to concede until it's really over. He's going to play a Vessel of Nascency here as well, but at 2 life, all Lukas Blohon has to do is attack. And he's in. Lukas Blohon is our champion for Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. Congratulations to him. He defeats Owen Turtenwald in 3 straight games.
He just won his last 9 games in a row.
Wow.
Jeez, he was down 0-2.
He was down 0-2, rattled off 3.
And just ran it.
Then 3.
Wow.
Unbelievable stuff. Hitting from a weird angle on the metagame with the black-white deck that
right?
I think people had kind of dismissed.
Okay, this just in. Planeswalkers are good.
And Lukas Blohon is your champion. Congratulations to him. We have to congratulate Owen Turtenwald as well for a fantastic tournament, but he's going to be a finalist here. We've got our champion. It's Lukas Blohon from Team Eureka. Man, tough way to go out, right? You know, the last, I mean, no matter.
I can agree with that.
Yeah, no matter what, you know, if you're a Magic fan, you don't want to see it end like that. But Lukas Blohan's going to take it. And that was really impressive stuff for him, especially in those first 2 games. We saw the raw power of Liliana. That was insane. I mean,
we saw back-to-back matches where Lukas beat Resolved Emrakul's.
Yes.
Like, because of Liliana Emblem. So you can't say that he didn't have some tough competition on the way there.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's going to do it for us in the booth here. Let's go check in with Rich Hagen at the news desk.
Thank you so much to Marshall Sutcliffe leading the team there. Randy Buehler, thanks so much to him alongside Louis Scott Vargas. And Randy, we're going to miss you. It's been an honor and a privilege to have you with us here on coverage for so many years. One of the great contributors to Magic history, not forgotten, and of course, still streaming everywhere you look with the wonderful streaming series that he does. So, Randy, thank you so much on behalf of everyone around the world. But, gentlemen, we have a winner. It is Lukas Blohon. He is your champion of Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. And Ian, once the guy said it there in the booth, from 2-0 down in the quarterfinals, he still needed nine game wins to win the title. And that's what he did in order.
Yeah, it's just incredible. I mean, the resolve and the focus it takes to just, you know, maintain the course after being 0-2 down in the quarterfinals. Just incredible. And I mean, watching him play and the way that he navigated these complicated board states and lined up the perfect answers against his opponent's threats all throughout the top eight was just incredible to watch.
So let me just check something in, because I'm not fantastically strong on the story.
Mm-hmm.
I think what's happened is that Emrakul turns up often and repeatedly. People really struggle to deal with her. And then Liliana turns up and says, I got this. Is that a fair summary?
Yeah, basically. So Liliana really saves the day with her horde of zombies, and that's exactly what we saw here unfold in the top eight of the Pro Tour. Pretty incredible.
Yeah, fantastic stuff. All right, let's take a look at the bracket for the top eight here at Eldritch Moon. We'll work our way through the day as we saw eight phenomenal players come in to action here. We had Sam Pardy, Andrew Brown, Lukas Blohon, Ken Yukihiro, Louis Scott Vargas, Reed Duke, Yuta Takahashi, and Owen Turtenwald. And we'll show you how that all panned out. Louis Scott Vargas kicked off up against Reed Duke, and unfortunately for Ian, BDM, this was a pretty straightforward win for Louis.
Yeah, Louis Scott Vargas chose to play bad company for this tournament and showed us why it was such a powerful deck, was able to come out very aggressively in the first two games and be able to pivot into a longer game in game three and was able to take it in three games against Reed Duke.
Then we had Yuta Takahashi up against Owen Turtenwald. This was Team Emerge against Bant Company. And Owen Turtenwald emerged from that, no pun intended, by 3-1. Pretty straightforward for him. We went into the top half of the bracket, and the number one seed was Sam Pardy with his black-green Delirium deck up against Team Emerge for Andrew Brown from East West Bowl. Ian, what happened in that one?
That was a pretty tight match between two decks that have very powerful mid-games. Andrew Brown flooding a little bit in the first game. Ultimately, it was Sam Pardy that triumphed in that matchup with his black-green Delirium deck.
And that left Lukas Blohon up against Ken Yukihiro. A terrific matchup on the face of it. That's how it panned out. BDM, the game of two halves, and when there are five games, well, you can't really have a halfway, so somebody had to win game five.
Yeah, like I said earlier, it's rare that you get a little tidbit from playtesting on the floor, and it plays out exactly the way the team predicted it. Lukas Blohon, they said, was a terrible underdog in the first two unsideboarded games of their match and would probably go 0-2, but that the matchup swung so wildly in their favor after sideboarding that they legitimately expected him to go 3-0. Lukas almost won one of those first two games.
Right.
Came very, very close to doing that against Ken Yukihiro, but it wasn't to be. And then he rattled off three in a row.
Mm-hmm.
And started a trend that continued on through the rest of the day.
Absolutely. So let's get to our semifinals. And we began with Owen Turtenwald up against Louis Scott Vargas. That was a real box office killer. Bant Company against Tima Emerge. And it did go the distance. It was back and forth. Louis led 1-0. He led 2-1. It went back to 2-2. And in the end, Owen advanced with Tima Emerge. Did you expect that over five games in that matchup?
I expected Owen to be a favorite, but at any point in the matchup, it was just so close, such a back and forth, even within each game, and then the games within the match. It was just anyone's match at any point.
Also, for a five-game set, BDM, look, pace of play, it's a bit like baseball. It's nice for the game to progress. And we got through five games in just a little over an hour. So if you do have some time spare, go back and watch that five-game set. You're going to learn so much. It was super exciting, super close, but also super crisp and precise, and they got the job done. Well, great job by both.
Yeah, great match to watch by two just players at the peak of the game. Not just at the peak of their game, the peak of the game. I mean, it's two players who are just utterly dominant right now playing Magic with this ease and understanding of everything that's going on for both of them, and it was wonderful to watch.
So then we had Sam Pardy up against Lukas Blohon. This was black-green Delirium up against white-black Control. Blohon had won his last three games to claim the quarterfinal slot. Well, then he won his fourth, fifth, and sixth consecutive games to advance to the final. Now, Ian, I think that was a bit of a surprise to see a sweep in the semis.
It absolutely was. Going into that match, those decks look like they're playing a very similar game. They're both sort of black-based, mid-ranged focus decks with plenty of creature removal. I thought it would be a very, very close matchup and that it could have gone either way, but Lukas Blohon actually swept the match. Very, very impressive to watch.
Brian, a terrific performance by Sam Pardy, number one seed coming in, the only player in this top eight who was here for his first Sunday appearance. Got a win under his belt, so that's a nice another thing off the list. It's always, you know, it's always a tough feeling when you come in, it's your first Pro Tour top eight, and then, oh, and now I'm out and it's 10:30 in the morning. I guess I'll go see Sydney. But he didn't do that, so great job, Sam Pardy.
And Sam Pardy's gonna have a great week. He's here with his family. His family comes to visit him at one Pro Tour location a year, and he's actually gonna be in Sydney for the week with his family, touring around and seeing the city. So he's He would have liked to have lasted, you know, delayed the tour about an hour or two, but he's pretty happy, I think, with his result this weekend.
So we get to the final, and in the final, Owen Turtenwald Tima emerge up against Blohon's white-black control. I think we all felt, Ian, that Owen was probably a slight favorite, at least. It certainly didn't pan out that way.
Yeah, absolutely. I was actually down there on the floor with the Pantheon guys watching that unfold, and going into it, you know, they thought Owen was the favorite. I actually talked to Owen while the semifinals between Sam Pardy and Lukas Blohon was going on. I said, Owen, which of these players would you want to advance? Who do you think you have the better matchup against? And he said, I want Lukas Blohon to advance. We played a ton in testing of my Teamer Emerge deck against white-black control. It was winning all the time. We really liked the matchup, but things certainly did not play out that way in the finals. And I have to imagine, is that due to some of the innovations that Lukas Blohon brought with his deck? Could we be seeing the start of the new post-Pro Tour metagame with these control decks that are actually prepared to beat Emrakul?
Yeah, control decks that are prepared to be Emrakul. I mean, that just sounds absurd, but I absolutely agree with you. BDM, it would be tempting in this seat right now to say, Owen Turtenwald, of course he might be a little disappointed, but he had a tremendous season. He's player of the year. He must be thrilled. But we both know Owen better than that, and he will be just bewildered, in a sense, that he has not run the tables and hasn't just walked away with absolutely everything. No,
there's nobody on the Pro Tour who wants that win more than Owen Turtenwald. I can make that statement with full confidence that it is true. I mean, there's nobody who wants that more, nobody who puts in more work and brings more focus to the table in pursuit of that win. I know it was crushing for him to start the season at the World Championship, to lose in the finals of that event, you know, now see him lose in the finals of another event at the end of the season. That creates an amazing season that saw him get elected to the Hall of Fame, that saw him become the Player of the Year, that sees him as the midseason master, that sees him, you know, as the U.S. national champion going back to the World Magic Cup, right? That sees him make two Pro Tour top eights, you know, and tremendous, tremendous season from Owen Turtenwald, but there's a bitter taste for him, I know, until he gets that trophy, and that's one of the things that makes Owen such a great Magic player.
He finishes the season, by my reckoning, on 98 pro points. That is a nuts total, given that, especially Ian, he spent half the season at home watching the coverage.
Yeah, just incredible. I mean, I know, I think Kai was maybe one of the only players to actually get over that 100 point total. That was during a time period when there were 6 Pro Tours in a year, if I recall correctly. So,
right.
I mean, just an absolutely astounding number of points. Owen has had a tremendous season. He's definitely established himself as one of the best players in the world, and it was just fantastic to watch all this weekend.
Now, of course, both Lukas Blohon, your new Pro Tour champion, and Owen Turtenwald, your new player of the year, are just 2 of 24 stellar names that will be joining us at the World Championship at PAX. The three of us will be there, all the team will be there to bring you 5 days of amazing action. And BDM, before we move away from Owen, unfinished business coming at the World Championship.
There's a bevy of rematches available to Owen Turtenwald at the World Championships. He could rematch Seth Manfield, he could rematch Lukas Blohon, he could even rematch Sam Pardee, who he played he owes a win too from the Swiss rounds.
So we will see how that all pans out. But for now, we're closing in on the end of the season. It's time for all the awards and trophies to be given out. Here comes the award ceremony for Pro Tour Eldritch Moon.